الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to do the life of Imam Abi Dawood and then we do Tirmidhi after that. So we're going to do the life of Al-Imam Abi Dawood and also inshallah ta'ala study a bit about his Sunan. So every scholar that we speak about the author and we speak about the book. But what I want you to all understand is, brothers, all of these Imams, they can be spoken about for weeks, maybe months. What I'm giving you here is the drop of the ocean of what can be said about these a'imma, and I mean that. To talk about Imam Abi Dawood's Sunan that took him years to author, we can't do it in 1 hour, let alone the life of the author. But what we can do, inshallah ta'ala, is if we can't do everything or we can't tackle a topic in its totality, we do the best, sah. And we mention what we are able. Write this down, inshallah ta'ala, before we go into the life of the author. Al-Imam Al-Hafiz Ibn Al-A'rabi. Al-Imam Al-Hafiz Ibn Al-A'rabi. Ibn Al-A'rabi. He's one of the students of Al-Imam Abi Dawood. And he's one of the narrators that narrated the Sunan from him. We're going to see him later, inshallah ta'ala. He said something very powerful. He said, لَوْ أَنَّ رَجُلًا لَمْ يَكُنْ عِنْدَهُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا الْمُصْحَفِ الَّذِي فِيهِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ هَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَمْ يَحْتَجَّ مَعْهُمَا إِلَى شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ الْبَتَّةِ. Pay attention, it's a big statement. He said, if a person only memorized the Book of Allah and Sunan Abi Dawood, and he had no other knowledge, he said, لَمْ يَحْتَجَّ مَعَهُمَا إِلَى شَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ الْبَتَّةِ. He will not need any other knowledge. He will not need any knowledge whatsoever. You know why? The Qur'an is the speech of who? Allah Azza wa Jalla. And the Sunnah is attributed to who? The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You have the Qur'an and the Qur'an and the Sunnah. And the Qur'an and the Sunnah is many types, right? We spoke about it. There's many types of Sunnah. The Sunnah that's in Sunnah Abi Dawood, we're going to speak about it later, is regarding Ahadithul Ahkam, jurisprudent rulings. Halal and haram. And that's the most important thing after aqidah. After a person perfects his aqidah, he needs to learn what's halal and what's haram. Fada'il a'mal, virtuous actions, heart softening, they all come after. Are we all together? The person needs to learn aqidah first. When he gets aqidah, what does he need after that? Ahkam, rulings. Tahara, salah, zakah, sawm, hajj, do and don't. Al-Hafiz Zakariya As-Sajiyu rahimahullah, he said, Al-Hafiz Zakariya As-Sajiyu, he said, Kitabullah, the Book of Allah, is what? Asrul Islam. The Book of Allah is the foundation of our religion. What's the foundation? The Book of Allah. وَكِتَابُ أَبُو دَاوُودِ أَهْدُ الْإِسْلَامِ. And the Kitab of Imam Abi Dawood is the covenant of Islam. Ahd, the covenant. That each and every one of us has to hold on to. The promise that we have to hold on to. That we need to come with. That's regarding his book, right? That's regarding what? His book. What about him, Al-Imam Abi Dawood? Musa ibn Harun, the great Hafiz, who died in the year 294 Hijriah, he said, خُلِقَ أَبُو دَاوُدْ. Abu Dawood was created في الدنيا. He was created in this dunya لِلْحَدِيثِ for hadith. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ and in the day of judgment لِلْجَنَّةِ مَا رَأَيْتُ. I never saw أَفْضَلَ مِنْهُ, anyone greater than him, he said. So the day of judgment, we hope for Abu Dawood Jannah. No one's sure. We hope. And in this dunya, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created him for hadith. وَلِذَلِكَ some of the scholars, they said, لَيَّنَ اللَّهُ لِأَبِي دَاوُودَ الْحَدِيثَ كَمَا لَيَّنَ لِدَاوُودَ الْحَدِيدَ. Allah made hadith soft for Abu Dawood the way he made the metal soft for Nabiullah Dawood. Allah made hadith soft, easy for Abu Dawood the way he made the metal what? Didn't Allah say about Nabiullah Dawood, وَأَلَنَّا لَهُ الْحَدِيدِ, that we made the metal soft for Dawood. Dawood used to make armor with his own hands. The helmet, he'll make it with it. He never used to, Nabiullah Dawood never used to burn the metal to make it reach a temperature where he can bend it. He didn't need that. As soon as he grabbed the metal, it will bend. And he could carve it with his own hand. Allah did that for Nabiullah Dawood. And Abu Dawood, Allah made knowledge of hadith like that for him. That's what they said. And last week, remember when we were talking about the six scholars of hadith? We were talking about Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i. What did we say? We said that two of them are mujtahid mutlaq. What does it mean, mujtahid mutlaq? They can look at the Quran and the Sunnah and extract a ruling from it directly without looking at whether someone preceded them or not. And who are the two we said that can do this? Al-Imam al-Bukhari and who? Al-Imam al-Abi Dawood. These two, we said they were mujtahid mutlaq. This is the highest level a person can reach. They read the Quran and they look at the Sunnah and they stipulate, they extract from both of them rulings and regulations. This is the mujtahid mutlaq. There are the mujtahid, like in the reason why we say mutlaq is because there's mujtahid which is muqayyad fi madhhabin muayyan. He's a mujtahid in a particular madhab. He can do ijtihad in the Shafi'i madhab, but he can't do ijtihad in totality. Al-Imam Abi Dawood and Bukhari, they could do ijtihad mutlaq. They were of the caliber of who? Al-Imam Shafi'i, Al-Imam Ahmed, Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, these were mujtahidin mutlaq. Now we're going to go into the life of the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, Al-Imam Abi Dawood. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, his name is Sulaiman. That's his name. Al-Imam Abi Dawood's name is what? Sulaiman. Sulaiman is his name. His father's name is Al-Ash'ath. Sulaiman ibn Al-Ash'ath. Al-Ash'ath ibn Ishaq. But he's well known as what? Abu Dawood. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, he is from, and he was born also in Sijistan. That's why he's called Abu Dawood As-Sijistani. As-Sijistani. So his name is Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath. If you learn that much, Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath, his kunya is what? Abu Dawood. And he's from Sijistan. So he is what? Sijistani. That's what he is. Sijistani. Very good. And he was born there. Al-Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah ta'ala. Bilad al-Sindh. Sindh, where is it now? In India, na'am. It's part of, it's spread between Kandahar, it's big land, and part of it does enter India. Are you with me? Pakistan now currently known as Pakistan, na'am. Now currently known as Pakistan. Al-Imam Abi Dawood is Sijistani. Just to show you that the ajab, that these were not Arabs, foreigners. From those lands, they came, they supported Islam, they defended the religion, and Allah raised them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This religion does not look at your background and where you're from. It doesn't care. You can be from whatever land you like. What honors you is not your background, or your lineage, or your people. That doesn't honor you. Mecca was once upon a time a place where the companions were told to migrate from. Land does not honor you. And it was a land they were commanded to come back to again. So your land, your country doesn't honor you unless you become something for this deen. And Imam Abi Dawood, he was born. Now we're going to go to wiladatuhu. When was Al-Imam Abi Dawood born? Al-Imam Abi Dawood, he was born in Sijistan when the year was 200 and 10. He was born, rahimahullah, sanata thnataini wa mi'atayn, 202. He himself said this. His student transmitted this from him. Abu Ubaid al-Ajurri, he said that sami'tu Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath Aba Dawood yaqul wulidtu sanata thnataini wa mi'atayn. I was born 200 and what? How many years was he after Al-Imam Bukhari? 8 years. So between Al-Imam Abi Dawood and Bukhari is how many years? Bukhari was how many years older than him? 8 years, na'am. What year was Al-Imam Bukhari born? 194. And he was 9 years after him in death. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, how many years? They said that it was 8 years, and he just went 9 one day, and then he died. Some of the mu'arrikhin, they say, he was 8, but the day he was sick when he was 8 years, am I making sense? How many years was he died after Imam al-Bukhari? 8 years. So it was 8 years. Sorry, 9 years, 9 years. What did I say? I said 9 years. On the 9th day, when he turned 9, he died. Am I making sense? So he got sick when it was 8 years before, and just when the day turned 9, he died. Rahimahullah. Now we're going to talk about Nash'atu wa Usratu, his upbringing, Al-Imam Abi Dawood, and how his upbringing was like, and his family. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, he grew up in a fi usratin muhibbatin lil ilm, a family that loved knowledge is where he came out from. He came out from a house that the religion and knowledge was loved. His father, Al-Ash'ath, he's from the Ruwat, the narrators who narrated from Hammad ibn Zayd. His father, he narrated from Hammad ibn Zayd. Are we all together? Al-Imam Abi Dawood's father narrated from who? Hammad ibn Zayd. and his brother Muhammad, who was a little bit older than him. His brother Muhammad Ibn al-Ash'ath, Abi Dawood's brother, was also from the people who traveled with him in seeking hadith. They traveled together, both of them. His brother Muhammad, who was a little bit older than Abi Dawood, he traveled with him. If we get time, inshallah ta'ala, we will mention he's traveling and where he went. But his brother, his older brother, traveled with him and sought knowledge with him. So this is the kind of environment Al-Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah came out from. And this, we have to do a waqfa. We have to stop at this point and realize something. That we need to make our households a place like this. Look what Allah said to Nabiullah Musa and his brother Harun. What did Allah say? Allah said, وَجَعَلُوا بُيُوتَكُمْ. Who can finish off? Huh? Qibla. Make your houses Qibla. Do you know what it means, make your house Qibla? Make it where a place Allah is venerated. Allah is glorified. Allah is mentioned. Why is it that the famous hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? He said, pray the sunnah in where? In your houses. Why? Don't make your household a grave. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَا تَجْعَلُوا بُيُوتَكُمْ قُبُورًا. Do not make your houses a graveyard. Go and pray in your households. So Isha, don't pray the sunnah of Isha in the masjid after you pray Isha. Take it home. Why? Because your children are going to see you pray. Huh? The children are going to see you pray, and this is, has effect on the child. And your children seeing their father pray and standing up and praying. And so Imam Abi Dawood, he came out from a house like this, where his father was a student of knowledge. And this moved on to Imam Abi Dawood. He took the passion of what his father was like. And his brother also took that passion on board. And he started to seek knowledge. And really and truly, brothers and sisters, your children really love what you love. They look at you and they can tell when you love something. And that energy that you come with when you're doing it, because you love it, when you love something, you do it with passion. And you do it with style, because you love it. That is going to go to the heart of your children, and it's going to affect them. So sometimes you see parents drive their children to the Quran class, and they say, go, go, memorize the Quran. And you say to your child, it's important that you memorize the Quran, and it's important that you finish the Quran. But if it's important, why don't you do it? If it's important to finish the Quran and memorize it and to seek knowledge and become strong in the deen, then why are you not doing it? Sahih. It doesn't make sense to the child. Are we all together? I mean, when we were young, my father memorized the Quran. But when we were young and we would finish Quran and our father would talk to us about memorizing the Quran, sometimes as kids we would say, Dad, read it. Read the Quran for us. We would test him as kids. Sah? You get excited and you say, Dad, read this. And when he reads, we smile. Daddy knows. Hakada. And that's what your children do to you. I mean, a lot of you might have seen that, sah? Your children sometimes ask you questions and they test you and they throw things at you, and it encourages them. So if you want to have Al-Imam Abi Dawood come out from your house, or a great imam like this, then make sure your household is somewhere that this kind of scholar can come out. Don't make it a house where 50-inch plasma television is there, you buy him a game, and he plays. Some parents, they come to me, and they've understood from cultivating the child by telling the child to do this and don't do this. But the first thing you need to do is you need to prevent the problems first. Al-wiqayatu khayru min al-ilaj. Prevention is better than cure. Stop the bad things that are coming into the house first. And then you can bring the good. Are we all together? ولذلك علي بن أبي طالب, when he came to the ayah, يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا. What did he say قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا means? He said علموهم وأدبوهم. Look what he said. He said علموهم. Educate your children. أدبوهم, what does it mean? Ibn al-Qayyim explained it. أدبوهم means educate your child and observe him. Once you've told him that he needs to pray, you're supervising him. You're checking up on the child if he's actually getting up and he's praying. You're telling your child, go and do wudu. And he comes out and he just flashes, throws water at himself and he comes out. You need to supervise whether he did the wudu correctly. Are you with me, brothers? And sisters, this is very important. وَلِذَلِكَ It's vital that the concept of tarbiyatul awlad is very well understood. So Imam Abi Dawood, he was born in Sijistan, as we mentioned before. As for where he was born in Sijistan, within Sijistan, it's not clear yet. What village? Scholars didn't mention it. As for his family, we already mentioned it. And Imam Abi Dawood, let's talk about his immediate family, he himself, his family. He was married. And Imam Abi Dawood was mutazawwijan. He married, he had a wife. Walahu khadim. And what did he have? Had a servant. Rahimahullah. If we get time, we might speak about that more. If not, we will just stop there. And Imam Abi Dawood, he had a son called Abdullahi. His son Abdullahi, his kunya is what? Abu Bakr. Have you guys heard of the Aqidah book, Manzumatul Ha'iyah? Who's heard of Manzumatul Ha'iyah? It's an Aqidah book. You've never heard of it before. Okay, remember this book. It's called Manzumatul Ha'iyah. It's an Aqidah book. Aqidat Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah. It's written by Imam Abi Dawood's son. Abu Bakr wrote it. Imam Abi Dawood's son, Abu Bakr, he has an Aqidah book called, it's called Manzumatul Ha'iyah. Manzumatu Al Ha'iyah. You know these books that you guys hear sometimes, Ha'iyah, Daliyah, Lamiyah. The reason why it's called that is because the last shatr, the last part of the nadam, it finishes with that letter to the end of the book. The reason why it's called Ha'iyah is because every sent line, it finishes with what? Ha. Every bait, what does it finish with? Not every shatr. Every bait, what does it finish with? Ha. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah's kitab is called Lamiyah, right? Lamiyah to Ibn Taymiyyah. Why? Because it finishes with Lam. And that's a skill, right? As a skill to start a book and finish it with what? With one letter. So he has Aqidah book. He also even has another book, his son. His son is an imam. And Imam Abi Dawood's son, Abu Bakr, is an imam. Yusharu ilayhi bil banan. He has a book called Al-Masahif. He has a book called Al-Masahif. And I advise you all to buy that kitab, Al-Masahif. Are we all together, brothers? This kitab, Al-Masahif, it talks about and it refutes the Orientalists who speak about the Mus'hafs and the Qur'an, the differences and the wordings and how the Mus'haf of Uthman, when it came, and the difference of the Masahif Uthman sent to the different lands, each Mus'haf and how it was and the sciences related to that. His son, Al-Imam Abi Dawood's son, authored a book in it. Are you with me? And look at this. Al-Imam Abi Dawood was asked, shall we take knowledge from your son? And he said, no, don't take knowledge from him. They asked him, shall we take knowledge from your son? He said, don't take knowledge from him. The reason is because when a father praises his son, it's a praise towards what? Himself, right? It comes back to him. Like he's kind of indirectly, who praising who? And they didn't like the idea of praising themselves. Like the scholars did not accept that. They did not accept that because they can see his nobility and his righteousness and his how great he was, Al-Imam Abi Dawood. Abi Dawood's son, Abu Bakr. This book, the Masahif, I want to mention some benefit of it. The Kitab Al-Masahif. This Kitab Al-Masahif, one of the first, if not the first, person who brought it out when the publishing and the printing houses came to the Muslim world was a bit late. The Muslims, they woke up and they realized the printing press and publishing house, it came late to the Muslim countries. Are we all together? The first country that had it was Egypt. Printing house. One of the earliest, early. The Ottoman Empire brought it there. And it was in Egypt. Ala kulli hal, this Kitab al-Masahif, the first person who brought it out was an Orientalist. It was an Orientalist, a mustashriq. He read it and he manipulated the book. Altered it, changed it, used it in his own advantage. And so the scholars that came after it, they received more manuscripts, they corrected what he played with, majority of them at the beginning of the book, they spend hours of pages of refuting the doubts that he's brought forward, because he wants to prove the Quran is what? It's not preserved, and that the Musahif Uthman sent was different, and the Sahabas had different Musahif, and their letters were different. And this shows us, subhanAllah, how important it is that we Muslims read and study and we go through our knowledge and read it. And if we sleep, then others will benefit from it. Isn't it not sad that we're behind in the world and then even our deen, others are coming into it? Don't you find that sad? That's how it's becoming. The virtues of Al-Imam Abi Dawood and the good character of Al-Imam Abi Dawood. Al-Imam Abi Dawood had great noble characteristics in knowledge and in action. See, this is important. To have makana ali, a high position in knowledge, and to have a high position in action. And he was a person, Al-Imam Abi Dawood, who had high aspiration. He used to implement what he knew. He used to follow the sunnah greatly. He was a very aesthetic person. Person who left his dunya and the glitters and the glamours of this dunya. It didn't resonate in the heart of Al-Imam Abi Dawood. And the scholars, they praised him for that. Let's mention each of those. Number one, how Al-Imam Abi Dawood would follow the sunnah. How tough he was on the sunnah, and that he wouldn't like the sunnah to be changed around him and on himself. Listen to this. The scholars, they said, Al-Imam Abi Dawood resembles Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, his teacher. They said that Al-Imam Abi Dawood resembles Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he resembles Waqi' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. Waqi' ibn Jarrah. And Waqi' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi, he resembles Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. And Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri resembles Mansur ibn al-Mu'tamir. And Mansur ibn al-Mu'tamir resembles Alqamah. And Alqamah resembles Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud resembles the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's you see, the silsila, the chain of how these scholars, you see, tasalsul, each person resembles their teacher, and the teacher resembles this, and hawahakada. Not in ilm only, and even in amal. So I have Al-Imam Abi Dawood. He resembles Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal resembles Waqi' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. Waqi' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi, he resembles Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri resembles Mansur ibn al-Mu'tamir. Mansur ibn al-Mu'tamir resembles Alqamah. And Alqamah resembles Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud resembles the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This resembling is what? Ilman wa amalan. Resemblance in what? Knowledge. Their knowledge was pure, untainted. Purely from the Prophet to this. These are all imams, one passing over to the other. And also the action. I will write those names on the board for you later, inshallah ta'ala. Al-Imam Abi Dawood had what was known as Izzatu Nafs. What does Izzatu Nafs mean? Self-esteem, self-respect. To respect yourself. Al-Imam Abi Dawood didn't humiliate himself for anyone. And this is a good character for a person. This is not pride and arrogance. It's knowing to respect yourself and to respect the knowledge and what you're holding onto. You don't humiliate yourself for anyone. You don't belittle this deen and you don't belittle what you're carrying. And Imam Abi Dawood, listen to the story. This was a story that took place with the leader, the wali. He came to Al-Imam Abi Dawood and he said to him, I want you to teach my children privately. I want you to give my children a private lesson. No one else is allowed to sit. Just you and my children. And Al-Imam Abi Dawood, rahimahullah, he said to him, Amma hadhi, as for this request, because he asked him for a couple of things, three things he asked him. He said, as for this request, which is for me to teach your children privately. He said, Amma hadhi fala sabila ilayha. There's no way to this. I can't do this. Why? لأن الناس شريفهم ووضيعهم في العلم سواء. لأن الناس شريفهم ووضيعهم في العلم سواء. The most honorable person and the lowest of low when it comes to knowledge, all of them are the same. Meaning anyone who's from a high background or a person who's from a low class, it doesn't matter. When it comes to seeking knowledge, everyone sits on the floor the same. This doesn't, no one has it. So he said, I can't do this. And you have to remember that this includes the leader is going to give money, connection, reputation. And Imam Abi Dawood saw it, that he has to be fair with everybody. Rahimahullah ta'ala. So this was something regarding his what? Izzatul Nafs, the respect that he had for that knowledge that he carried. Also his zuhd. And Imam Abi Dawood was very zahid. Zahid meaning he turned away from this dunya. Because this dunya, brothers, the way we've perceived it and the way we see it today is mukhalifu lilwaqa. It's opposite to the reality. Why? Because Allah, who created this world, who owns this world, said, لو كانت الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى منها كافر شربة ماء. This dunya does not equal to the wing of, it doesn't equal to Allah and does not equate to, in the eyes of Allah, a wing of a mosquito. Doesn't, not even a wing of a mosquito. If today Apple came out and they said, the company Apple, and they said all the iPhones that we've produced, they're rubbish. There are faults in there. Would the people debate with Apple? Or would they say, these are the manufacturers, they're the ones who made it? Sir, Allah created this world and He's telling you it's nothing. And the evidence to show you that this dunya is nothing is the fact Allah gave it to the non-Muslims and the Muslims, same. ولولا أن يكون الناس أمة واحدة لجعلنا لمن يكفر بالرحمن لبيوتهم سقفا من فضة ومعارج عليها يظهرون ولبيوتهم أبوابا وسررا عليها يتكئون وزخرفا وإن كل ذلك لما متاع الحياة الدنيا والآخرة عند ربك للمتقين. This dunya Allah gives it to the Muslim and the non-Muslim. Everyone has it, no problem. ولذلك if some Allah gives you this dunya, it has no evidence, it's not an indication Allah loves you. Just because you have money and this, it doesn't mean Allah loves you. And just because Allah took the dunya away from you, it doesn't mean He hates you. لكن if He doesn't give you the day of judgment, Jannah, He does not love you. والآخرة عند ربك للمتقين. آخرة is for the believers. So this dunya, these ulama, they didn't see it to be much. They only saw this dunya as to be a place to accumulate actions for the day of judgment. And they didn't see this dunya as to be the final, ultimate goal. It's not the ultimate goal. It's a stepping stone to the ultimate goal, which is the day of judgment. And Allah referred to this dunya as what? Something that's going fast. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَاجِلَةِ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْمُومًا مَدْحُورًا وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَأُولَئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُ مَشْكُورًا كُلًّا نُمِدُّ هَؤُلَاءِ وَهَؤُلَاءِ مِنْ عَطَاءِ رَبِّكَ وَمَا كَانَ عَطَاءُ رَبِّكَ مَحْظُورًا انظُرْ كَيْفَ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَلَلْآخِرَةُ أَكْبَرُ دَرَجَاتٍ وَأَكْبَرُ تَفْضِيلًا. Allah referred to the akhirah as what? Greater and bigger and better. And the dunya, what did he refer to it as? Man kana yuridu? Man kana yuridu al-ajila. Anyone who wants this hasty world that's going fast. Bal tu'thiruna al-hayata al-dunya wal-akhiratu khayrun wa abqa. You see, the akhirah remains. This dunya, Allah referred to it as what? Subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, وَمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَهُنْ وَلَعِبْ وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. What does it mean, Ibn Kathir, when it came to this ayah, وَمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَهُنْ وَلَعِبْ وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ. He said, A, الحياة الدائمة المستمرة الذي لا زوال له ولا انقضاء بل هي مستمرة الأبد الآباد. This is Ibn Kathir's kalam. That this dunya, I mean the akhirah, is the real life. It's forever going to remain. And that was truly the reality of Imam Abi Dawood and others and the Sahabas. Allahumma la aisha illa aishul akhirah. Faghfir lil ansari wal muhajira. That there's no life except the life of the hereafter. That's why, brothers, your jobs, money, everything that you're making, you're accumulating, you're gathering, it should be of benefit towards your hereafter. Somehow has to play a role in the establishment of your hereafter. Whether you pay in sadaqah and you give it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, whether you use that money to increase yourself in beneficial knowledge and righteous action, it has to play a role in that regard. And Imam Abi Dawood, let's go across some of the statements that he had said about the world and this life and everything. He said, "Ash-shahwatul khafiyya." These are one of the great statements of his. He said that the hidden desires that's hidden in many people, it's a hidden desire, is what? Hubbu riyasa. Hubbu, the love of leadership. Hubbu al-riyasa. It's the love of leadership. And this, does it go against the akhirah if you love the dunya? Naam, Allah tabaraka ta'ala said, tilka ad-daru al-akhirah naj'aluha lil-ladhina la yurid tilka ad-daru al-akhirah naj'aluha lil-ladhina la yuriduna tilka ad-daru al-akhirah naj'aluha lil-ladhina la yuriduna 'uluwan fil ardi wa la fasada wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin. They don't want 'ulu fil ard. They don't want to be high in this earth and big, and everybody looks at them, Allah, do you know who just went by? Allahu Akbar. They don't like that. They like to be hidden. No one knows of them. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, one day, he came to a well. And then when he came to the well, it was in a place that no one knew him. No one knew who was Abdul Mubarak. And so they pushed him because everybody was trying to take the bucket and the water out of, and they pushed him in and around, and he was about to fall into the well. And then he looked and he said, "Hakada falyakun al-haya." I just wish the world was like this. That no one knew who I was. You know, no one gave me any importance. No one gave me any value. I just wish life was like this. Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, in the city of Baghdad, he said that he would scrape against the wall. And he would take the alleyways. Never take the main road, because he hated people stopping him and recognizing him. "Ahmed, how are you?" He didn't like it. And Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said, "I wish people took knowledge from me and nothing was attributed to me." And that no one ever said that. Shafi'i said, "I just wish that knowledge," because he wants the reward to give the knowledge, but he doesn't want people, Shafi'i, Ahmed. None of that. So this is another example of the tawadu, the humility and humbleness of these great scholars. Is Al-Imam Abu Dawood, he wrote a risala called Risalat Abi Dawood ila Ahli Makkah fi wasf sunanihi. Al-Imam Abu Dawood, he wrote a letter. The people of Makkah, they asked him about his sunan. "How is this book? How did you author it? Can you explain it to us? What did you mean here?" You know, they wanted to know and have an understanding of the book. So he wrote a letter to explain it. Look what he said inside it. This shows you how humble he was. He said, "فَرُبَّمَا تَرَكْتُ الْحَدِيثَ." Sometimes I may leave a hadith. I mean, I bring it, but I leave it. "إِذَا لَمْ أَفْقَهُ." If I do not understand this hadith, I don't say anything about it. What did we just say he is? Mujtahid mutlaq. He's a mujtahid mutlaq, and he's saying it. He knows that knowledge is an ocean. To claim that you know it all is impossible. He's saying that maybe I might come across a hadith that I don't understand it. What does he mean, "I don't understand it"? Here he means, "I don't understand it." أي لم يتبين لي سلامته من العلل. I don't know whether it's free from any defaults, mistakes, the errors that are in this hadith, the weakness in this narration, it still hasn't become clear to me. That's tawadu of the Imam. He's attributing to himself what? That he may not know. And Imam Abi Dawood, when he died, and Imam Abi Dawood, after ba'da hayatin hafilatin bil jiddi wal ijtihad, after spending years of his life dedicating it for the religion, spreading it and teaching it, and giving, rahimahullah, death came to him like it will come to every single person. Allah says in the Quran, "وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ كِتَابًا مُؤَجَّلًا." And Allah says another ayah, "وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ." Allah says to the Prophet, "I have not made Muhammad anyone live forever." That's never. If you die, Muhammad, do they think they're going to live? Nabiullah Muhammad died. Death is a hatmun lazimun. It's a reality. It's even something that even atheists agree with us on this. Huh? Is there a dispute about death? No. And it's sad that the most agreed upon thing became an ijma', whatever religion you hold, wherever you come from, and it's the least prepared for. Huh? The one thing that every people, every nation, everyone agrees that death is going to come to everybody. Sah? So, Al-Imam Abi Dawood, just like every other imam died, he died. And he died on a Friday. لِأَرْبَعَشَرَ بَقِيَةٍ مِنْ شَوَّال. 4 days, 14 days were left from Shawwal. And the year was سَنَةَ خَمْسٍ وَسَبْعِينَ وَمِئَتَيْنَ 275. Look how much Al-Imam, look how much is 275. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, look how I want you to remember this, brothers. This imam, and many imams you find, they used to stick to the sunnah when they were alive. Look, when even they're dying, they give a final verdict that the sunnah should be followed in the way that they die. And Imam Abi Dawud, look what he did. أَنَّهُ لَمَّا مَرِضَى. When he became sick and he became ill, he requested أَنْ يُغَسِّلَهُ حَسَنُ بْنُ الْمُثَنَّى. He said, I want this man, Hassan ibn al-Muthanna, I want him. His name is Al-Hassan ibn al-Muthanna ibn Mu'adh al-Ambari. I want him, who died the year 294. He said, I want him. He was a man who was righteous, aesthetic individual. And he's from the Nubala'i Thiqat, very reliable individual. Rahimahullah, Imam al-Dhahabi speaks about him in Sayyid al-Alam al-Nubala. The reason why he chose him is because he knew the hukum and the rulings pertaining to washing the dead according to the sunnah the best. لِتَقَدُّمِهِ فِي ذَلِكَ. He was the forefront, the most knowledgeable man in washing the dead body according to the sunnah and how it should be done. He was the one who knew it the most. The narrations, the evidences, the views, the opinions, he knew it the most. So he said, I want him to wash me. I want this man to be the one who washes me. This is what he said. He said, if you guys, whatever reason he doesn't do it for me, or he passes away, or he doesn't come, or whatever, it doesn't happen, then I request that the kitab written by Sulaiman ibn Harbin, who he narrated from his teacher Hamad ibn Zaydin, that book is brought and it's used as an instruction to wash my dead body. فَعْمَلُوا بِهِ. Implement that book. The kitab written by who? Sulaiman ibn al-Harb. He narrated from his teacher, Hamad ibn Zaydin. I want that book to be used as an instruction. The evidences and the statements that are in there, I want that to be used for my body to be washed. Are you with me, brothers? So these individuals, they implemented the sunnah when they were alive, and they made sure that it was implemented after they died. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy onto Al-Imam Abi Dawood. And may Allah give him subhanahu wa ta'ala great reward. And may Allah accept from him the hard work that he put forward for this ummah. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah has the ability. And may Allah resurrect him with the Prophet, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose sunnah he served. May Allah resurrect him with him, the Day of Judgment. Now we're going to go into the kitab written by Imam Abi Dawood, his sunan, and get some understanding regarding the book. There's so much that can be said about his journey and his traveling and his students and etc. So many things. If you go to my channel, I have five parts, each an hour taqriban, which I spoke about the Sunnah Abi Dawood and his Sunan in more details. But now we're just going to go over it fast. Now we're going to go to his Sunan. We're going to go into the Sunan of Al-Imam Abi Dawood. So let's start with the name of the book. This book, what is it called? Ismul Kitab. What's the name of this book? The name of this book is Sunan Abi Dawood. The kitab is called Sunan. And it's attributed to the author, so you don't confuse it with other Sunan. The Sunan of Abi Dawood. But the kitab is called Sunan. Why is it called Sunan? Because the author called it. Remember I told you he has a risala, a letter, where he wrote to who? The people of Makkah. And in there he said, فَإِنَّكُمْ سَأَلْتُمْ. You guys have asked me, أَنْ أَذْكُرَ لَكُمُ الْأَحَادِيثَ, that I explain for you the narrations, الَّتِي فِي كِتَابِ السُّنَن, that's in the Sunan. You want me to explain it for you. So what did he call it? He called it Sunan. He called it what? Sunan. So the kitab is called Sunan. Point number two regarding the book. What mawdu'ul kitab, What does this book deal with? What does it discuss? I already mentioned it to you. It is Ahadithul Ahkam. It's what? What does Ahadithul Ahkam mean? Jurisprudent rulings. We're talking about fiqh issues. You're not going to take heart softening from Sunan Abi Dawood. In other words, the book is not written for raqa'iq. It's not written to speak about the virtues of the companions. It's not written to do tafsir of the Quran. It's not written to manaqib and fada'ilul a'mal. It's not written on that. This book is written for what? Hukum. Rulings, verdicts. He says it himself, وَإِنَّمَا لَمْ أُصَنِّ فِي كِتَابِ السُّنَنِ إِلَّا الْأَحْكَامَ. I never authored anything in this book except ahkam. Mentions all of that is sunan. So you're not going to find fada'ilu al-a'mal, you're not going to find zuhud, aestheticism from this book. Hukum. How many ahadith are in it? He himself says it. So we'll take what he said. He said, 4,800 hadiths. All of them in what? All of them in ahkam. All of them in what? All of them in ahkam. When did he author it? When did he author this book? Al-Imam Abi Dawood, the time that he authored this kitab, it's hard to restrict it and narrow it down to a particular timing. It's hard. It's hard to say that this was the time he authored it. And to say that this was the moment that he wrote it. What's the best publication that I would advise you all to buy? If you wanted to read Sunan Abi Dawood. The best publication out there right now is the publication that was put together by Daru Ta'seel. Daru Ta'seel. Rather, Daru Ta'seel, I personally think it's the best in all the six books of Hadith. Daru Ta'seel. It's the best for all the six books of Hadith. Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Virgil, and Nasa'i. What we did one time was, we sat down, me and a group of brothers, and we took the Kutub al-Hadith al-Sittah, the six books of Hadith. Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. And we made a circle. Everybody brought a different copy. What did they do? Different publication of the same book. And everybody read a portion of the book. Reading fast. And we want each person to have a different copy. And then if anybody felt there was a different statement in that, they would tell us it. And we would look at it. And then we realize Darul Ta'seel has the least mistakes. Like Sunan Abi Dawood, we only found two mistakes in it, the whole book. That's good. Two mistakes, the whole kitab. Are we all together? We look at the tab'a, we look first grammatically, it doesn't make sense, for example. Arabic is wrong. That's one way. Or the sharah doesn't have this in it. We look at the sharah of the hadith and other ways. In English, is Sunan Abi Dawood? I don't know English. Is there Sunan Abi Dawood English translated? Yeah? Darul Salam. Okay. What's the best sharah for the kitab? Sunan Abi Dawood, or one of the best shuruh and explanations is the sharah of, it's called Aunu al-Ma'bud. Aunu al-Ma'bud. Aunu al-Ma'bud. Fi sharh sunan Abi Dawood, it's called. And it's written by the great Indian scholar Shamsul Haq al-Abadi. It's called Shamsul Haq Abdul Azim al-Abadi. ولذلك, this sharah is very good. Are you with me, brothers? Shamsul Haq Abdul Azim al-Abadi. Abadi. His sharah is very good. Ibn Raslan, the great Shafi'i scholar, he has a sharah of Sunan Abi Dawood. Al-Khattabi has a sharah of Sunan Abi Dawood called Ma'alim al-Sunan. What is it called? So Shams al-Haq, Abdul Azim al-Abadi, second one is Ibn Raslan. He's a sharah of Sunan Abi Dawood, which is published, walillah alhamdu wal minna, recently came out. Back in the days, we didn't have it. We used to read it through wasa'it, through means, through other books. But now, alhamdulillah, it came out. The sharah of Ibn Raslan, the great Shafi'i scholar. The third person I mentioned is Khattabiyu, Abu Sulaiman, Muhammad ibn Hamad al-Khattabiyu, Ahmad ibn Hamad al-Khattabiyu. He has a kitab called Ma'alim al-Sunan. One of the early scholars who explained it. It's good. And there's also the Tahdhib al-Sunan of none other than the great scholar, Al-Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. Ibn al-Qayyim authenticated, graded the hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood, and he also explained it in his book, Tahdhib al-Sunan. And now, Maktabatul Islami, Maktabatul Ma'arif, what they did was, they placed on the Aunul Ma'bud of Abdul Azim al-Abadi, at the bottom, they placed the Tahdhib al-Sunan of Ibn al-Qayyim. And the Hukum, and the rulings of who? Sheikh Albani. Because Albani has what? What does Sheikh Albani have? He has Sahih Sunnah Abi Dawood and Da'if Sunnah Abi Dawood. Sheikh Albani. So they took that and they placed it inside the Aun al-Ma'bud. So really, when you buy Aun al-Ma'bud, you get the rulings of Albani on that at the bottom. You also get the rulings and the discussion and the explanation of who? Ibn al-Qayyim in there, which is the Tahdhib al-Sunan. And the kitab aslan, the sharah is who? The sharah is who? Abdul Azim al-Abadi. Abdul Shams al-Haq al-Abdul Azim al-Abadi. Huh? I think it's Maktabat al-Ma'arif. Okay, now let's go into the narrators of the Sunan. If you guys want, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to send you the, inshallah ta'ala, the, what's it called? Risalat Abi Dawood. Risalat Abi Dawood ila Ahli Makkah. رسالة أبي داود إلى أهل مكة في وصف سننه. The letter Abu Dawood wrote in what? In describing his what? His Sunan. My teacher from back home Somalia, he worked on the رسالة أبي داود إلى أهل مكة. رسالة أبي داود إلى أهل مكة. He worked on it. Meaning he collected and he brought manuscripts together, he worked on it, he spent time on it, and he even explained it. And I haven't seen anyone who's done a better job in the tahqiq of the kitab than him. So far, he's the best. Every time somebody comes and then, yeah. But so far, he's one's the best. And it would be nice if one time we can go over it. Like if we studied it, that risala that he wrote, it will give us more understanding of the Sunan. Now we're going to go into the narrators of the kitab. We're going to go into the ruwat, the people who narrated the Sunan of Al-Imam Abi Dawud, who narrated it from him, rahimahullah ta'ala. Five are the main ones, inshallah ta'ala. There are many, but five are the main, inshallah ta'ala. You need to memorize these five and know them, because these different narrators have different wordings in the Sunan Abi Dawud. Because remember, Abi Dawud, the kitab, it was evolving. Some students, they took it from it at an early stage, and then some took it at his later stage, and then the copies are going to be different. Some things he changed, he took it out. Some he let it. So the first one is Abu Ali. Abu Ali Muhammad ibn Ahmed. Abu Ali Muhammad ibn Ahmed ibn Amr al-Lu'lu'i. Al-Lu'lu'i. He died the year 333. And the reason why he was called Lu'lu'i is because he used to sell Lu'lu'. Pearls, huh? Pearls, huh? Lu'lu in English is pearls, right? Khiwayatal Lu'lu'i. You're going to hear that a lot. When you study Sunan Abi Dawud, what are you going to hear? The narration of who? Khiwayatal Lu'lu'i. You're going to hear that. What are you going to hear? Khiwayatal Lu'lu'i. It's this man's riwaya. And it is asahur riwayat, the most authentic riwayat. Note that down. Why? Why is it the most authentic riwayat? لِأَنَّهَا مِنْ آخِرِ مَا أَمْلَى أَبُو داود. It's the last. It is the last presentation of Abi Dawud. This is the final edition. Riwayat al-Lu'lu'i is the final, it's Ardatul Akhira, is the final presentation. He had it the year Abu Dawud died. So this is the final one. The second one is Abu Bakr Muhammad ibn Dasa. Ibn Dasa. Dasa. Dal Alif. Seen ta marbuta. That's the second narrator. And Ibn Dasa, he is the Shaykh of Abu Sulaiman al-Khattabi that I told you, the one that authored the kitab Ma'alim al-Sunan, one of the explainers of the what? Sunan Abi Dawud. One of the people who explained Sunan Abi Dawud, I said it was who? Abu Sulaiman al-Khattabi, Ma'alim al-Sunan. This is his teacher, Ibn Dasa. Ibn Dasa is what? Ibn Dasa is the teacher. The third one is Abu Isa Ar-Ramli. He is also from the narrators. That's number three, right? Number four, Abu Isa Abu Sa'id Al-Arabi. And last but not least is Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn al-Hasan ibn al-Abd al-Ansari. Al-Abd al-Ansari. So just write Abu al-Hasan al-Ansari. Those are the main narrators of what? Sunan. Quickly, let's go over how many books are inside the Sunan Abi Dawud. Remember Sunan Abi Dawud? How many kitab? How many kitabs are in there? How many books are in there? There are 36 books in there. How many? 36. Tahara, Salah, Zakat, Luqtah, Luqatah, Al-Manasik, Al-Nikah, Al-Talaq, Al-Sawm, Al-Jihad, Al-Dahaya, Al-Sayyid, Al-Wasaya, Al-Faraid, Al-Kharaj, Wal-Imarat, Wal-Fay, Al-Janazat, Al-Aiman, Wal-Nudur, Al-Buyu, Al-Ijaza, Al-Aqadiyah, Al-Ilm, Al-Shriba, Al-At'ima, Al-Tib, Al-Itq, Al-Huruf, Wal-Qira'at, Al-Hammam, Al-Libas, Al-Tarajjul, Al-Khatim, Al-Fitan, Al-Mahdi, Wal-Malahim, Al-Hudud, An-Adiyat, An-Sunnah, An-Al-Adab. All of those are the kutubs that are in it. How many? 30? 36. Ibn Majah, how many does it have? 37. Al-Imam Ibn Majah. How many does he have? 37. Tirmidhi has 50. Tirmidhi has how many? 50 kitab. Nasa'i has how many? 51. Muslim has what? 53. And Bukhari has 97. Who wrote it? How much does Abu Dawud have? 36. What about Ibn Majah? 37. What about Tirmidhi? 50. What about Nasa'i? 51. What about Muslim? 53. What about Bukhari? 97. Bukhari has 97 kitab. How many ahadiths, taqriban, did we say? Lakin, when we got the last presentation of the book with the riwayat al-Lu'lu'i ibn Das and all of the riwayat, today the number, the exact figure that we have is 5,274. With all of the riwayat and everything, it's 5,274. So how many difference, what's the difference taqriban between what we mentioned now? It's about 470 something, right? 74. Ha, taqriban. Ha. And Ibn Udasa and stuff like this. There's little differences here and there. Taken. Yeah. So you guys have an understanding of the book and the author himself. Any questions? No. What did I say? What did I say that was for? Huh? When we break down all the riwayat of... The riwayat of who? Al-Lu'lu'i and Ibn Das and all of them. This is how much numbers we have. Meaning, according to the publication that we have today, this is exactly the number that we have. Because sometimes the scholars, when they count the hadith, they may count it different in the way that they choose to count it. Al-Fadbal. The who? The Al-Imam Abi Dawood. Yes, too much. We didn't mention all of them. So many kalam, wise statements that he said. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Huh? The Kitab al-Musahif. Is it better than al-Itqan? Now, Itqan is all ulum al-Qur'an. Itqan is ulum al-Qur'an, the whole science of the Qur'an. Like in al-Masahif, it's only a part of it. Which is the what? The Mus'haf, that's it. Specific to the Mus'haf. It doesn't talk about Nasikh and Mansukh and all of that. It doesn't go into that. It just talks about the Mus'haf that we have. It won't talk about tafsir or anything. Fadal. There are da'if hadith in Abu Dawud. So, the kitab Sunnah Abu Dawud, what do we have in it? A hadith which are da'ifa. Sometimes he even mentions them, they're da'if. Especially when he can't find a hadith which is authentic in this issue, he will just bring one weak hadith there, of Imam Abu Dawud. And Shaykh al-Bani rahimahullah ta'ala, what did he do? He came and he authenticated it. He got rid of those hadiths and corrected them and authenticated it. Lakin, is Shaykh al-Bani's authentication a final proof? Yeah. And Shaykh al-Bani, he didn't accept the rulings of some of those who came before him. When he looked at it himself, he felt that they were wrong and he's right. And somebody may come after Shaykh al-Bani and say the same to him. Are you with me? Sheikh Albani rahimahullah ta'ala looked at Ibn Hajar's works and disagreed or agreed, صح? And somebody's going to do the same to Sheikh Albani. So we're not mut'assib for Sheikh Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. Like when you go against Sheikh Albani, don't just go against him because of hawa, desires, or Ibn Hajar or others. If you go against them, then you should go against them based on the science that you know. If you know the science, go against them based on the science and in a correct way. Does that make sense? Naam. His own student, Sheikh Albani, didn't agree with all of his gradings. So sometimes they differed. Walidarika, Sheikh Mashur, who worked on the kitab itself, Sunan Abi Dawood, and took out, what he did was he organized it. He took out Sheikh Albani's, you know, reasoning. So Sheikh Albani explains why he weakens narrations. All he did was, he just took out that, and next to the hadith, he just wrote da'if and sahih. So the person can just look at it, who's an ammi, and he knows it's sahih or da'if. Even he doesn't agree with all the gradings of the Sheikh, his own teacher. Which one came first? The first, inshallah ta'ala, is Bukhari, la shak. And then it's what? Muslim. And then it's Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, in terms of authenticity, right? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, when it comes to the four sunan, he's the most authentic. Are we all together? So it's Bukhari, Muslim, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. And then Al-Imam Abi Dawood. And then Tirmidhi. And then Ibn Majah is last. But that's in terms of what? So you see, it depends where you're looking at it. We looked at it in terms of authenticity. Like if we look at it in terms of, what do you call it? The fiqh and the Al-Imam Abi Dawood is better than Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. If somebody wants to learn a hadith al-ahkam, this is better to memorize. Are we all together, brothers? But if you look at it from the angle of mentioning some benefits and some nice gems and the views of the fuqaha, then Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi is better. Tirmidhi will say this is, when he mentions the hadith, he'll give you a ruling and he'll say, this is the call of Sufyan al-Thawri or Shafi'i or Ahmed, or he'll tell you. So he's got those extra benefits. Does that make sense? In terms of authenticity, it's Al-Imam al-Nasa'i is the highest from the four. And then Abu Dawood, and then At-Tirmidhi, and then Ibn Majah. That's just the issue of authenticity. The Aun al-Ma'bud with the Tahdib al-Sunan on there and the Sheikh Albani's grading and everything, it's Maktabatul Ma'arif. That's what I believe. It's called Maktabatul Ma'arif. Any other questions? Yeah.
How did Imam Abi Dawood die?
Who?
What was the cause of his death?
Natural death. He just died normally. He was ill, he became very sick, and that's it. According to scholars of hadith too. According to the scholars of hadith, if two sahabas narrate it, then it's two different hadiths now. So when it comes to a hadith al-ahkam, it's good to memorize. After a person memorizes the 40 hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawi, after you finish the 42 hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawi, the person should memorize the kitab Umdatul Ahkam. And then the person should memorize Bulughul Maram. We're talking about hadith al-Ahkam. Bulughul Maram. These two books, one does not suffice you from the other. One cannot suffice you from the other. And you have to memorize Umdatul Ahkam and Bulughul Maram. It's student of knowledge, if he memorizes this book, I've said this before, if a person memorized the Hadith of Bulugh al-Maram, and then he also memorizes the Kitab in Madhab al-Shafi'i, for example, Minhaj by Imam al-Nawi, or if you're a Hanafi, if you're a Hanbali, you memorize Az-Zad, Zad al-Mustaqna. Are you with me, brothers? Or if you're a Maliki, you memorize Muqtasar al-Khalil. Or if you're a Hanafi, you memorize the Hidayah of Marghinani. All four madhabs, right? With the Bulugh al-Maram. And you memorize one of those texts, whichever madhab you're from. And you memorize the Bulugh, you are truly a faqih. And you understand it, of course. You've combined between hifd and fahm. You are a faqih. You deserve to be asked questions of the religion, and you can give verdicts. You have every right to give fatwa. What do you have? حُقَّ لَهُ أَن يُفْتِي. The person has rights to give fatwa. Memorizes عُمْدَةُ الْحَكَامِ, finishes it, goes to بُلُغُ الْمَرَامِ. Once he reaches بُلُغُ الْمَرَامِ, he goes for any of those four texts based on whichever madhab he follows. He has rights. You know Sheikh Ibn Baz, Sheikh Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz? Ibn Baz, whether he was traveling or whether he was a resident, the person with him, because the Sheikh was blind, would always carry Bulugh al-Maram and read it on the Sheikh. Finish it, start it again, finish it, start it again. Sheikh Ibn Baz used to carry with him Bulugh al-Maram and Tafsir Ibn Kathir. Bulugh al-Maram and what? Tafsir Ibn Kathir. And what was he? Yeah, he was the Mufti al-Am. He was the Mufti, the whole, yeah, he was a big Mufti, the Allama Ibn Baz. وَلِذَلِكَ if you listen to Shaykh Ibn Baz's answers on Nur al Darb radio and the questions when he's asked and he responds, listen, look what he says. He says, رَوَاهُ الْخَمْسَةَ. Who says رَوَاهُ الْخَمْسَةَ? Ibn Hajar says in Bulugh al-Maram. The five narrated it. These are istilahat according to Ibn Hajar. Ibn Baz used that. He would say that. You can see he memorized Bulugh al-Maram. He memorized it. Ibn Baz bi-itqan, kalima kalima, harf harf. Are you with me, brothers? People undermine this kitab, lakinnahu wallah, by Allah, this book is something else. This kitab, Bulugh al-Maram, is a kitab. Once the person then finishes it, which I come to your question, is that if a person does finish that, he should first go for the ahadith, Bukhari and Muslim both agree. What is it called? متفق عليه الشيخان. The Ahadith Bukhari and Muslim both agree. So the Hadith that we call what? What do you call it? We call it متفق عليه. Once you finish the Hadith Bukhari and Muslim both agreed upon, then you go for the Hadith Bukhari is alone in. Which is going to be little, right? And then you go for the Hadith which Muslim is alone in. Now what have you got? You've got some ahadith now left that you didn't find in Bukhari or Muslim that is in where? The four sunan. Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. You memorize all of that. It's called Zawa'id al-Arba'ah. A couple of thousand, you swallow that. What have you finished? This is a systematic way of memorizing. You finished the six books of hadith in memory, and you've done it from Arba'in al-Nawiyyah. Does that make sense? If a person combines, brothers, between Hifd and Fahm of these books that I'm mentioning, Hifd, he memorizes, and Fahm, he understands them, that's what knowledge is. Some people today, they just want to understand. Biduni hifd, they don't want to memorize a little bit hata. No Quran, no nothing, just want to sit there, just look at you like that. Are you with me, brothers? Hifd, have to memorize. ولذلك, the thing that you can truly claim is what you memorize. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen said, rahimahullah ta'ala, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen said, the knowledge that benefited us the most is what we memorized. Ibn Uthaymeen said this. The knowledge that benefited me the most, Ibn Uthaymeen said this about it, himself, is the knowledge which I memorized. What I memorized benefited me the most. You know why? Because what you memorize is what goes with you. When you need it, you can just extract it. You don't say, I wish I was in my library. Wallahi, I would have shown you. Is that what you're going to say when somebody asks you for a fatwa? Somebody comes up to you and says, is this permissible? And you say, no, it's not permissible. And they say, what's the evidence? And you go, what? What do you mean, evidence? Akhi, come on, you know I'm a reliable person. Come on, I wouldn't just say it. Is that what you're going to say? You have to, قَالَ رَسُولَ قَالَ اللَّهُ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Allah said, oh, the Prophet said, it has to be on the tip of your tongue. It has to be on what? Does that make sense? I'm Shafi'i, so I tell people to Kitab al-Minhaj, Imam al-Nawi, it's the best. Like in the Hanbali, we'll say to you that, it's the best. If a Hanafi was standing here right now, he would say, Hidayatul Marghinani. You know the Hanafiya, they went overboard with the Hidayah by Marghinani. Look what they said. They said, إِنَّ الْهِدَايَةَ كَالْقُرْآنِ قَدْ نَسَخَتْ. That the Hidayah is like the Qur'an. It abrogated all of the other books. Meaning, what did the Qur'an do? It abrogated all the previous books, right? The Torah and the Injil and the Zabur. So they said, إِنَّ الْهِدَايَةَ كَالْقُرْآنِ قَدْ نَسَخَتْ. They said, لَمْ يَأْتِ قَبْلَهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وَلَا. Something like that. He said, فَحْفَظْ قَوَاعِدَهُ وَسْلُكْ مَسَالِكَهُ. Memorize its wordings. It's kalam, ajeeb. So you know, Shafi'iyya, the Shafi'i scholars, they got upset with that. Because that's a direct attack to the Shafi'i. And they said, no problem, it is. It's the Qur'an of the Hanafiya. This is the Qur'an of the Hanafis. It's not our Qur'an. It abrogated all of the other previous books because it's your Qur'an. عَلَى كُلِّ حَالِ. All these books are good in the madhab. So the Hanafi madhab, their summary and the khulasa is in the Hidayah. The Malikiyya, the summary and everything is in the Mukhtasar al-Khalil. ولذلك, if you go to Morocco or if you go to Mauritania, you see little kids memorize Mukhtasar al-Khalil. They memorize, they swallow it, they take it in. Minhaj, al-Imam al-Nawi. If you go to YouTube and you type in Somali, they sit down and they read the Minhaj from the memories on YouTube. They're reading it together. They're taking portions. You know how many masail are in the Kitab Minhaj? 60,000 masail far'iyya fiqhiyya. 60,000 masail fiqh. They're memorizing it. Furu' fiqhiyya, you memorize it. If you memorize these 60,000 furu', like sub-branches, and you have the evidence to support it, isn't that good? What's missing from you? Only one thing is missing from you, which is the nawazil and the mustajaddat, the new things that are happening. And what do you need for that? You need qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. What do you need? Qawa'id fiqhiyya. You memorize the legal maxims. So you sit down and you memorize the kitab Fara'id al-Bahiyya by Al-Ahdal. Any new thing that happens today, you have a principle where you bring it back to. Sahih? Am I making sense? Any questions that anyone have? Huh? Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. You know, Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. His story, you know, I opened back in the days, I used to have a madrasa called Madrasatu Al Umariyyah. I've opened it. Have you guys heard of it? I opened it and there was a reason why I called it that name. What was there? A reason why. Now I'm Kelima. I'm not Madrasatu Al Umariyyah, okay? I'm Kelima. So, Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid, Ahmad al-Maqadis, these scholars known as al-Maqdisiyya, they have a story. Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, he his cousin, Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudam al-Maqdisi, who wrote the Kitab al-Mughni. I advise you all to go and read it. The author of this Kitab, his name is called Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. Read their story. Honestly, go and read their story. How they went from Baytul Maqdis and they stayed in Syria and they stayed in a place called Jabal al-Qasiyun and they built a madrasa called Madrasatu Al Umariyyah and how everything was established. And there were women in there who were muhaddithin, scholars of hadith. They were knowledgeable and they got eaten by a mosquito. Read their story. And they lost family members and how they were being chased by the enemies. When you read that story, you realize how much effort was put in seeking knowledge. And all you have to do is just put the key into the car and just park the car, get your coffee out and just sit and in a lesson. Wallahi. These scholars, they were dying from mosquito bites and they were dying from the water that wasn't clean, wanting to seek knowledge. And in the halaqah they were passing out, some of them were dying. Are you with me, brothers? So read this, their biography, especially Abdul Ghani, start with him and read his life and then it will stem out to the rest, inshallah ta'ala. Diya'ul Maqdisi and the others. And then realize, compare yourself with these people. Don't just read their lives, but compare yourself with them. How much effort are you really putting in seeking knowledge? How much are you really learning? This is the inheritance of the Messenger, brothers. Nabiullah Muhammad didn't leave money behind for his ummah. He left knowledge, ilm. If your father died, you would make sure that you take his inheritance. And you will not miss out. Nabiullah Muhammad says, inheritance has been given somewhere and it's being divided and it's being... Mahdalik, you're not there. You're missing from it. Ikhwan, knowledge. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala honors a people what they know. I advise you all, nurture yourself upon knowledge. However old you are, learn. Just learn. Don't stop. Until Imam Ahmad was old and they saw him and he was carrying a log, a big log. And he had, a pen and he was writing and they said, Ya Aba Abdullah, ila mata? How long are you going to seek knowledge for? Are you not going to stop? Now you're Imam. Everyone's coming to you. Are you not going to stop seeking knowledge? And he said, no. He said, مِنَ الْمَحْبَرَةِ إِلَى الْمَقْبَرَةِ مِنَ الْمَحْبَرَةِ إِلَى الْمَقْبَرَةِ From the cradle to the grave. From the cradle to the grave. I'll never stop seeking knowledge. And that's how they were. There's a kitab, it's called Al-Mushawwaq ila qira'ati al-kutub, something like that. It's written by Sheikh called Ali al-Imran. And there's another kitab written, it's called Safahatu fi Sabri al-Ulama'i. It's the patience that some of the scholars showed when they were seeking knowledge. It's these two kitabs, you'll cry when you see the way that they exerted and the time that they exerted in seeking knowledge. Literally, Ibn Aqil, what he said? He said that the time I hate the most is when I have to eat. Eating time was the worst for him. We like that time. It means a lot to us. We wait for that moment. We've called the family together, we come under the table and enjoy and roll up our hands and, yeah? They hated it the most. Some of them, عند الاحتضار. عند الاحتضار, the moment they're dying, the nafs is being taken out of them, they will revise fiqh issues. Those books mentioned it, wallahi, fiqh issues. Which one is better? Abu Yusuf, the student of Abu Hanifa, was asked, and he's dying on his deathbed. He asked those around him, he said, look, which one is better? To go around the Kaaba 7 times on your riding beast or to walk? And he's waqtin al-ihtidar. Abu Zur'at al-Razi, he was on his deathbed, he's passing out, he's just about to die. What did he do? They saw him dying and they want to say to him, say La ilaha illallah. Because they remember the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, مَنْ كَانَ آخِرُ كَلَامِي مِنَ الدُّنْيَا لَا إِلَى اللَّهِ دَخَلْ الْجَنَّةِ أَمَا لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So they started the chain of the hadith. And then when they started the chain, each one mentioned the chain, and it came to him, and he finished off the chain. And then he mentioned the Prophet's statement, which is, anyone who says, La ilaha illallah, will enter Jannah. And he said, Man qala la ilaha illallah, and he died. You see, so this, brothers, is really what it is. Knowledge and learning, gaining understanding of the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Every day, brothers, that comes by in your life, make it your vision. Every day that comes by, your knowledge of the religion increases and your actions increase. If there comes a day where your knowledge doesn't increase and your actions don't increase, that's a day you failed. That day was a lost. You lost that day. Because look what Allah says about the Prophet. What did he say? هو الذي أرسل رسوله. What did Allah send Muhammad with? بالهدى. What was the second? ودين الحق. What is هدى? Beneficial knowledge. هدى here means beneficial knowledge. ودين الحق, what does it mean? العمل الصالح. Righteous actions. Nabiullah Muhammad came to establish on this earth beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. So every day in your life, your knowledge has to be greater and more, and your actions have to be even better. 5 days ago, if I met you, I have to see different person, the way you carry yourself is totally and utterly different now. Because every day you're growing, you're growing, you're growing, you're growing, you're growing. And that's why knowledge is important. May Allah make us from those who have great knowledge of His deen and those who implement what they know. Any other questions? So everyone here agrees that they're going to come to those that class. وَإِنْ كَانَ صَعْبًا Even if you find it hard, have in your heart, inshallah it won't be hard, trust me, inshallah ta'ala it won't be hard. لكن you're not going to expect knowledge to just enter your heart. It will never just be like that. Nothing is like that. But that you, inshallah ta'ala, come with the effort and the dua and you ask Allah ta'ala to give you the tawfiq and the sadat. The information regarding it will come out soon, inshallah ta'ala. So we have 15 days and we have 10 different books. 10 what? Different books. The way that I plan to go through it is as follows. I will be sitting on a chair. You guys are going to give me a chair, right? So I will sit on a chair, and the plan, inshallah ta'ala, is there's going to be a brother who's going to read the Arabic, so those who know the Arabic can benefit from it. And another brother is going to read the English for the text. So before I even explain what the Shaykh is saying, you already know what the text is. Oh, am I making sense, brothers? So you already know what the text is. When I come in, I'm just going to give you bullet points of what that paragraph means. If it needs evidences, I'll give you the evidences. And you just note down the evidence. Is that something hard? Huh? Is that something hard? Does it seem like it's going to be hard? Inshallah ta'ala. That's really how it's going to be. And then inshallah ta'ala, in the future, next time when we do it again, we may make it a bit more more extra explanation. And then more explanation. And then more explanation. You know, the thing that people always get wrong is the kitab Nukhbatul Fikr. Have you guys heard of it? Who heard of Nukhbatul Fikr? Nukhbatul Fikr. Nukhbatul Fikr is a science of hadith book. This kitab, Nukhbatul Fikr, is how many hours is it taught in? And how many days is it taught in? Some scholars, they teach it in 7, 8, 9, 10 days, that book. But do you not know the author, when he wrote it between Dhuhr and Asr. ألفها الحافظ في حال السفر. He was a traveler. He was on his riding beast, Ibn Hajar. And he authored it. ألفها الحافظ في حال سفر وهو شهاب بن علي بن حجر طالعتها يوما من الأيام فاشتقت أن أودعها نظامي فتم من بكرة ذاك اليوم إلى المساء عند وفود النوم مشتملا على الذي حواه فالحمد للرحمن لا سواه. He was traveling, he was on his riding beast. Between two salahs he wrote it. So when the person who is explaining it treats this book like it's so big, what does it defeat? It defeats the purpose of the author. And the author didn't see his book to be a what? Mutawwal. He saw it to be a mukhtasar. He authored it for somebody to read it. And they just put it down and say, that's it. So that's how these books are in its essence. Like, and it got treated like it's what? Got treated like a big book. Because some of these books, when I showed it to some brothers, they were like, is this how small it is? Because all this time they were seeing what? A two-volume explanation. And so they thought the book was two volumes. You see, the way that a scholar is when he comes to teaching knowledge is that he simplifies things. That's the asal. العالم الرباني يربي الناس بصغار العلم قبل كباري. These books should be treated small. But what it does need is, see, I can do it as easy as I want. And I can simplify it as easy as I could. But the truth of the matter is, if you're absent-minded and you're thinking about, you know, inshallah ta'ala, next time my salary when it comes through and this is how much I'm going to invest into this business, I can't. Sahih? When you're coming, you have to come with your pen and paper, you have to have a mind which is clear, you have to come with the aspiration, the drive, the motive, then inshallah ta'ala, we're working together now. And some people, because this is new to them, it's automatically like negativity. No, learn to get out of your comfort zone. Explore things in life. Sah? Are you with me, brothers? You can't eat chicken curry every day. You have to eat biryani, you have to eat other meals. So the person has to change things and explore other avenues of seeking knowledge. And I think, inshallah ta'ala, those of you who've done the essentials, alhamdulillah, you have a good head start. Especially for a lot of the sciences, you have a good head start. Does that make sense? It will help you. It will what? A lot of it will make sense, okay? Because I took a lot of it from those books. Alhamdulillah. BarakAllahu feekum. So a hadith which is da'if, can we use it in ahkam? We'll leave that answer for the nukhbatul fikr. When we do nukhbatul fikr, there's a discussion in there we're going to do, which is, can you use weak narrations in jurisprudent rulings? We have to leave this place at 9 o'clock sharp.